Good afternoon, everybody, and thank you for joining once again, week after week. We are back here with Dr. Shashank Joshi and Dr. Harish Shetty, and we will be first doing COVID updates with Dr. Shashank Joshi, and then we'll move on to mental health, since the topic of the day is COVID-19 and mental health. Dr. Shashank Joshi, I would like you to take over.
So welcome, everybody, once again, and I welcome Guru Anna. You know, we are WHO celebrating the World Mental Health Week. And therefore, today's show is dedicated to Guru Anna and mental health of people. But we need to look at COVID is still around. COVID has virtually disappeared from north of India. They are not reporting state by state more than 15 cases, 20 cases, 30 cases, 50 cases per day after testing 80,000, 1 lakh, 1.5 lakh. But when we come down a little bit to Maharashtra, we still report around 2,000, 3,000 or 4,000 cases, but they have declined dramatically. But there have been, after Ganesh festival, we had anticipated an increase, and still Mumbai is reporting around 400 cases. Test positivity rate of Mumbai has not dropped down. It's around 1 to 1.5%. You must have heard that fully vaccinated resident doctors of KM Hospital, 29 of them tested positive, and they are all quarantined now. Two of them are admitted to the hospital. We wish them a speedy recovery. And COVID is still around in districts of concern, led by Ahmednagar, Kolhapur, Sangli, Satara, Pune are still very much prevalent. Sindhudurg, Ratnagiri, Raigad, and Palghar, and Thane, and Mumbai are still very much prevalent. Rest of Maharashtra, probably COVID has disappeared. From tomorrow onwards, the schools will be opened. In 3 days from now, when Navratri starts on Thursday, the various places of religious worship shall be opened under strict SOPs. And fundamentally, then, around 20th of the month, we'll see the opening of theatres, cinema halls, multiplexes. Everything will be under supervision. India has recorded a large, big milestone. 90 crore Indians have been receiving at least one dose of the vaccine. This is a very, very significant, compelling number. And 1/4 of India now has received two vaccines. So at least 1/4 of the adult eligible Indian population has received two vaccines. Of course, we need to move that number to 60% or 70%, but we are work in progress, and we are vaccinating at one of the fastest paces on planet Earth. So that is a good sign. First time in the last 3 or 4 weeks, we are seeing numbers which are below 25,000 per day in India. And the Kerala numbers are still around 15,000. So out of the 25,000 cases which are seeing in India every day, 15,000 are contributed by Kerala. Rest by a little bit around the south, Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, Andhra Pradesh, Telangana. Then a little bit from Maharashtra. And then, of course, the North Indian states, particularly Mizoram, remains a state of concern. One big news and ray of hope is an oral antiviral pill, which is made by Merck or Merck Sharp & Dohme or MSD globally, called Molnupiravir, like Favipiravir, has now been approved. And the company made an announcement that it cuts the deaths and severe illnesses by half. So we have an antiviral, which will be one tablet twice a day for probably 5 days, like say a anti-flu medication, like Tamiflu or Oseltamivir. Similar to that, now we have a medicine which might be there for the COVID flu also. Flu season is completely abated. It's still there. In fact, across India, there is a wave of dengue. There is a wave of malaria of different types, Plasmodium and Vivax. Vivax malaria is very much prevalent in Mumbai. We have chikungunya, which has come up, and various viral fevers, including typhoid. So the monsoons have hit us hard, and the non-COVID illnesses and tropical fevers are back again. So that is the current situation. Lot of people have apprehension of sending their children to school, sending their, they don't know, because for almost a year and a half, how the children will react, how the teachers will react, what will happen. There have been strict protocols, and you know that US is still having the large pediatric wave. Almost 25% of pediatric cases in United States are pediatric, and the pediatric intensive care units across the United States are full. But now, for the first time, US is also started showing a decline. Remember, whatever happens in US and Europe usually occurs in 3 months after that here. We don't see any major signs of third wave coming up, unless we get an unusual variant of concern or variant of interest. And right now, the next 2 months, if we follow the five fingers, which is strict double masking, strict distancing, strict sanitization, ensuring that we have a well-ventilated space or airy environment or open environment, and finally, we ensure that we are vaccinated. Apart from ensuring that we don't get into a crowded or a congregatory place, we are good on the COVID front. But you know, this apprehension with parents, apprehension with children to go back to school is a major challenge. And that is my first question to Guru Anna as we unveil the Mental Health Week. I have got frantic calls, even though I'm an endocrinologist, from mothers and fathers of children, because both the parents as well as children, there is no vaccine. So the question Guru Anna, they asked me is, Dr. Saab, there is no vaccine for our child. And the child has not gone to the school for a year and a half. We are more nervous than the child. Child is excited. And child is not very comfortable wearing a mask. And child is only 9 years old. So this is a very common problem in every household. So now how do we handle this? This is a huge problem with your expertise in the forefront of school health psychiatry. You are a foremost expert on planet Earth in this area. How does one handle such a dilemma where parents are apprehensive, they are anxious because their child is not vaccinated, they're also anxious that child may not be able to follow COVID appropriate behavior, and they're also anxious that child has to go to school. I feel the parental anxiety is higher than the anxiety of the school children. You're muted, sir.
No, I'm okay. Can you hear me now? I think the task force, pediatric task force, and the state government has taken a mindful decision to get children back. And as the task force has taken a mindful decision, it's the responsibility of the task force to have small meetings with all parents online. Not one meeting from Mumbai, but small meetings in every district. Relentless meetings before the school starts to reassure children, to reassure parents, and also to give them safety protocols. Safety protocols made in air-conditioned rooms is not enough. Transacting them through the task force of child doctors relentlessly is number one. Number two, there has to be a telephone line, hot number by the government of Maharashtra for every parent to ask all the queries, and the queries be addressed immediately so the anxiety goes down. The third thing is every school principal should have access to members of the task force 24/7 to answer the grievances, to manage their anxieties, and to give small solutions to problems which come up. So these facilities should be there. Only guidelines will not work. Active engagement with the parents, teachers, and children across the next 1 or 2 months is very important. Number two, I would request all parents to the task force mindfully have come up with this decision along with the state government. Please keep your communication on with all the stakeholders of the state. Keep your communication on with the ruling politicians or the politicians in your area who are very helpful, the municipal officers, the education officers. So with that, you'll find that anxiety goes down. A mask is not easy for even an adult. Even in the United States of America, there's an anti-mask belt in the United States. So every behavior would have teething issues. So really reinforcing the fact that the child has worn a mask, appreciating, giving an incentive, and schools at the same time reinforcing the safety protocols, not by instruction, but by inspiration. By songs, in fact, when we worked at Kandla with the cyclone for mental health, we created songs which were culturally very sensitive songs, and a lot of, I would not say hype, but a lot of movement for safety protocols, which are enjoyable, friendly, is necessary. In a month's time, Dr. Shashank, you will know the outcome of schools starting. But Dr. Shashank, I would like you to use your good offices. for asking the task force to be available, engaging, and asking the Honorable Chief Minister to have more sessions than they had with adults for children in the next 1 month. A helpline for anybody to pick up the call and ask. With this, anxiety will go down. At the same time, those who have had deaths in the family will be very reluctant to go to schools. They need special attention. Those who have had infections are very reluctant to go send their children to schools. They need a little more assistance. And along with that, if you look at the history of pandemics, I was reading Chinmay Tumbe's book, and we found that in the past, cholera or other pandemics came in waves in different parts of the world in different times. With all this, a lot of yoga, a lot of pranayama, and schools should not enforce a lot of studies at this point of time. Ghar vapasi is the key. School vapasi is the key. Let them enjoy, let them love, let them dance, and let them study little. This year is meant for coming back, school vapasi, and reintegrating the lost child or the child who was away for the last 2 years back to school. So back to school, ghar vapasi has to be done very mindfully, very, very joyfully, and as Dr. Shashank always says, very scientifically. And I think with this, we'll learn. I don't have all the answers, and nobody has all the answers.
Absolutely. Dr. Joshi, I have a...
One small point I want to talk on the children's front, to reassure children.
Yes.
Even Avinash Kinikar made this point.
Yes.
That just like adults, 80% have antibodies, a lot of children in sero surveys have shown antibodies. So it is likely that a lot of the children probably were already exposed. So that is a reassuring sign, but that doesn't mean we are reckless. And pediatric vaccine is also around the corner. And particularly between the ages 12 and 18, we have high COVID approved in India. And we will have the pediatric database also available. So that is also around the corner. So there is nothing to get worried, but we should follow COVID appropriately. Yeah, go ahead, Anil. Sorry.
Yeah, a couple of questions. So one is regarding the booster doses. So Bhavna Sarayaji is asking regarding the booster dose for healthcare workers. When would that be available?
So right now, the database on booster doses is very poor.
Right.
And the only recommended areas where booster dose has been recommended, US FDA was seized with this matter. They said give booster doses to people above 65. People who are exposed to COVID virus, like healthcare workers and frontline workers. They also said people who suffer from moderate to severe immunocompromised states below 65. They have approved boosters in the United States. In India, this is work in progress. We are evaluating the safety profile of vaccines and safety profile of booster being given with Indian vaccines. And that is work in progress, and that is being investigated very aggressively. We know the mRNA-based vaccines or platforms are the available ones in the Europe and US. They have had an association with myocarditis. We know the adenovector-based vaccines, which one of them, like Covishield, we use in India, has been associated in boosters with Guillain-Barré syndrome and a neuroparalytic syndrome. So obviously, the data is getting better and better. And now it is approved and perceived to be safe. Don't get carried away by antibodies. The spike protein antibodies are very misleading. We either do the receptor binding domain antibody or nucleocapsid antibody or virus neutralization antibody. And even then, you still can get into a challenge. I must offer my condolences to one of my class fellows who unfortunately passed away, and I would not name him here, who had taken two shots of the vaccine. He was an endocrinologist of eminence and unfortunately had 80,000 plus anti-spike protein antibodies. So we have to still mask. The strongest booster right now, till the booster is available from the NTAC committee of Government of India, which will study the data and approve it, is double mask, N95 mask. And Guru Anna today is leading from the front. He is now double masked himself in a cyber cafe in Mangaluru, and from where he is talking to us. That is the booster dose. So Guru Anna is the living example of the booster dose today. That is the best booster we have till the booster is available. And don't get carried away.
Another question I have from Dr. Avinash Kinikar is, has COVID stopped mutating? Mu has disappeared from US and only Delta is seen there. Are we done?
See, virus will mutate. Every 11 days, COVID mutates or the coronavirus mutates. But the derivatives which are coming are all Delta derivatives. So series of genomic sampling, which is occurring in Mumbai, Thane, Pune, Delhi, all the time they are showing delta derivatives and delta derivatives. No major new variant of concern or interest is cropping up right now across the world, which is a good sign. So probably the newer versions or the children of the newer COVID, which are mutating, don't appear to be as sinister as the delta variant.
Okay. All right. The one thing that Supriya Raji Singh ji was asking was the problem to going to school is also how will they commute? So how do we tackle this?
So the task force as well as the Maharashtra government has made a protocol of commute also, and they have factored commute as a part of the protocol in SOP.
Okay.
So that is something which is there. So let us move gears to the mental health. You have one more question?
Yeah, just one quick question regarding the timelines. When you mentioned the children's vaccine, is there a timeline that we sort of have regarding anyone
probably
that may be
next
available?
Next 2 to 3 months, it will be available by the end of this year. That is the earliest it will get available. So let us move back to mental health, because that's really the core focus of today. And we were talking about mental health with child psychiatry today. But you know now what has happened, Guru Anna, there is a lot of revenge tourism, revenge festivity, revenge enjoyment. Navratri is coming up in 4 days from now. And a lot of, like revenge tourism, there is a suspicion of rebellious revenge festivities, which can just lead to breakthrough infections, mutant strains, and so on and so forth. And now people are saying enough is enough. If Avinash Kinikar is saying Spanish flu took 3 years, but we have vaccines very fast, so maybe we'll take only a year and a half. So that, you know, mental threshold of patience, resilience is not there. And with Navratri on the anvil and Durga Puja in east of India, Navratri in west of India, and of course also in north of India, and with Deepavali festival also coming up very fast, the various rebellious and revengeful nature. And also, you know that during this time, people had not traveled. So there's likelihood of a lot of domestic travel across India. How do you view, Guru Anna, how does one handle this revenge festive season?
As you already mentioned that more than 20 resident doctors, in spite of 2 vaccines, have come positive. Our friend passed away, yours and mine. I knew this great doctor from his childhood. He was staying opposite my house in spite of 2 vaccines and of course, a lot of antibodies. Well, Durga Mata will not save you from the virus, nor will Lord Ganesh Ji. So again, I'm saying the responsibility of Papa figures, of people in the government, people that I would say, Dr. Joshi, each one member from your task force should have one session with people across the state of helping them to be mindful. There has to be a mammoth movement of mindfulness, of mindful behavior, of protocol following in spite of the festival. When you dance in the festival, see that you don't dance with your hands, you dance with the sticks, and the sticks are sanitized. But it's a very stupid way of saying this. But what is important in the core is COVID has not gone. Those antibodies and across the state is good. We have seen that antibodies alone are not protective of COVID. So a massive, each task force member and others talking to the state continuously, week after week, every day. One guy gets a turn at least once a week, and not the CM alone. It's very, very important. So you need to have a blitzkrieg, a media blitzkrieg, and a buzz that behave. And with that, I expect that a lot of people will improve their behaviors. But I would say that, Shashank, we need to actually wait for the festival to get over and see what happens. I don't want to predict, though every human being has a desire to predict. I would not want to actually predict. But these are the public health movement which needs to be done. It cannot be done individually. We are psychiatrists, psychologists, and endocrinologists are a patient. So please request the government to give a mammoth blitzkrieg by not only the Honorable Chief Minister, who is very good, but probably other members from the cabinet and collectors and doctors from the entire task force. School, And Navratri should be the priority as far as mental health communication is concerned. At the same time, Dr. Shashank, since we have mental health week, there's one issue I need to share with everybody, which is not related to COVID, is stopping of medications. A lot of patients, after they improve in 1 month or 2 months, come back to the doctor and said, medicines kam karo ya band karo, main achhi ho gayi hu, main achha ho gaya. I would remind every person who's on psychiatric medications for illness should understand that treating a psychiatric illness is not like treating fevers. You need to maintain, there are protocols in mental health as much as COVID, where probably if you have had one episode of depression, you need to have the same dose of medication for at least 12 months. At least it's important, and then the psychiatrist will bring down the medication and see if you actually. So do not force your behavior while buying vegetables. How ucha karo, thoda 4 kilo ka 18 rupaya kam karo na. And don't use this language with psychiatrist. He or she knows how long the medications has to be given. You may ask him why it has been given, but please do not stop, decrease on your own, or tamper with medications. Having a relapse, mental illness relapse of mental illness around the COVID era is not a good thing to happen. Yes, over to Dr. Shashank.
Absolutely, Dr. Shetty. It's absolutely true what you're saying, that it's important to have the mind mental resilience. There is a question that these hardships and tough situations will take a little longer to work. And that's very, very true. So, the question is that Jayo Pasha is asking this question. Those inspecting on traffic signals for not inspecting or wearing the mask are rule breakers themselves. The minute they come near the vehicle, they mask up. Many Uber drivers are to be reminded once customer sits in the car. I travel by Uber every day 50%. You have a time to give a good lecture. I think this is a very good technique to give Uber drivers a lecture, motivate them, and continuing doing that. Dr. Anna told us a very important thing today. Do not stop psychiatric medications or decrease them on your own. Do it under medical supervision. Amishi Desai Choksi is asking a very pertinent question. What is the status of Covaxin by WHO? As work-related travel is affected, and also there is a lot of challenges in the UK, which I saw in many places. So Covaxin has got delayed. They have asked for some more data from the WHO. Apparently, the company has given us a reassurance, as well as the Indian regulators, that eventually it will get an EUA from the WHO. But we have to be patient. We thought this would occur around Independence Day. It has got protracted for more than a month and a half now. Even September is over, and let us hope before Diwali, this approval will be in place. In UK, they approved Covishield at last. Initially, there was a challenge that if somebody went from India to UK with two Covishields, they were not approving it. But then you still need to do a 3-day, 5-day RT-PCR test and quarantine. So unfortunately, Government of India had to put some reciprocity measures in place, and that will be there. But remember two things. For global travel, vaccination is not something which you need to hold on to. Eventually, most countries for Delta strain, for people going from India, will ask you to quarantine and test again. And that is the safest option which is available. But yes, if your vaccine is available, they may allow you vaccine exemption. But I'm not so sure it will last too long. Right now, the laws, global laws on travel, tour, and vaccination are very, very changing all the time. Okay. So that's something which is there. Vandana Ji Gupta is asking ki home quarantine for people coming from UK, is it going to be monitored? Probably yes. Because we know that this, if it is not done, there'll be a challenge again. So there will be a reciprocal arrangement. And if they don't adhere to them, then there'll be institutional quarantine. So, if people are not following the rules and they try to break the law, in the UK also, people have to follow home quarantine. But if they break it, obviously, there are mechanisms to, make them go through institutional quarantine. So that's something which we need to recognize, that these are the new age challenges which we face. And now moving back to mental health, you made two valid points. One were to address parental anxiety and children's anxiety. and asking the reinforcement through task force to sensitize and do more programs for parents and school teachers, school going children, all of them. That's a well taken point and valid point. Second point, you talked about mental health, mental illness, and not stopping medications. Anna, even today and recently, you know, suicides were in focus. Suicides have been a lot in focus in COVID era. Is there any way to circumvent suicidal ideation, suicidal thoughts? And how does one person who's likely to get negative behavior or suicidal behavior, what type of interventions and how urgent is it to contact a mental health expert or a psychiatrist like you?
Thanks for asking this, Shashank. Very, very pertinent and very important. And I'll tell you a story. In fact, 8 days back, I was casually told by a 24-year-old son that his father has not gone to job for the last 2 years. And he feels he's very anxious. That's what he said. Maza baba pushkar gabaril hai tante jat nahi. And most of the times, Dr. Shashank, when family physicians and non-psychiatric professionals or even parents or even children, when they say anxiety, most of the time it's depression. So when I asked the son to bring the father, he said he will not come. So when I did an online session with his father on the bed, he was on the bed, he was completely lazy, equal to, lazy is the word which the family uses, complete psychomotor retardation. I would make use of this word. I want this word to be in common parlance in your constant narrative. Psychomotor retardation means mind is slow, body is slow. You don't feel like getting up. You don't feel like speaking. And it was not anxiety. It was depression, whatever reason. And I see a lot of such patients harboring. And he said, don't tell anybody. Jagun ka upyog hai. And when the sentence jagun ka upyog hai, he is now being treated with depression. In 8 days' time, there's some movement, he'll recover. Please please be very careful for anybody who talks about death and dying. I want to run away from the house is a suicide statement. I want to go to God is a suicide statement. I want to suddenly make a will is a suicide statement. I want to give away my entire property to ask them suddenly, not awakening, not existential, not dan punya. It is a suicide statement. So whenever you have these sentences uttered or these thoughts expressed, even remotely, indirectly, mental health checkup is a must. Do not brush them aside. Do not give them spiritual answers. Do not say three things. Tula kai kamiya hai? Ghara hai? Sagla hai? Paisha hai? Tula kai kamiya hai? Well, that kind of time, that person is down. Number two, don't say you have no courage or it is an act of cowardice. Courage is interpreted by the person who's healthy when he hears any suicidal thought from another. He says, oh, what courage? I don't have the courage. It's not about courage. It's not about cowardice. It's the state of mind. Number three, asa ghanyada goshti sangacha nahi. No. Number four, I know my son very well. I know my father very well. He has been always good. You have seen him for half an hour. You do not know. I know him. I know his mental health. You know his life. Knowing life is not important to understand mental health. Knowing mental health is important for me to tell you that you need to take help. Just like Dr. Shashank looks at the blood sugar report or the endocrine report, just as a pulmonologist puts a stethoscope on the chest of the patient, psychologists and psychiatrists also put a very mindful stethoscope on the mind of the patient. Please follow the instructions. Please see to it that mental health checkup is done. Dr. Shashank, in Japan, the suicide rates following COVID has increased. In India, actually, I'm seeing a lot of patients being depressed and not anxious, and unfortunately being termed anxious. So I would ask all families, ask all family physicians to err on the side of depression, even when somebody is saying he or she is anxious. And among the elderly, which is very important, the elderly say that they're very anxious. Remember, it could be depression. Screening for depression, screening for suicidal thoughts, and mental checkups are a must almost for everybody. It can be done online. It can be done with scales, which the psychologists or the psychiatrists can give you. Thank you, Shashank, for that very probing question.
One more mental health question, Guru Anna, for you is, people who have had serious psychiatric disorders, as well as people who are admitted to mental health institutions, do you think they are more at risk for COVID?
Absolutely.
After their vaccination, do you think that they still need vigilance, or they can be treated as normal people?
Then I would say, and it has been shown by research, that those who are mentally ill are more prone to the infection, and those who are mentally ill also have a longer COVID. Also, when you have given a lot of steroids, it so happens that at times that can also aggravate a mania, it can aggravate a mood disorder, it can aggravate also a psychosis in patients who have schizophrenia. So I would say that it is extremely important for us to take care of the patient much, much longer than what it is. Watch the mind and watch the body. Examine the mind and examine the body for much, much longer duration, so that they are genuinely and really taken care of. Yes, Dr. Shashank. And also about the mask, I just want to say just a line. I'm so happy. I was moving around a mall in Mangalore, and I found a lot of students not wearing the mask. The mask was on the cheek. And I reminded them, please wear the mask. And when you remind somebody to wear the mask, please don't be rude. Be smiling, be inspirational, and congratulate after he or she's worn a mask and move out. So what is important is they use a lot of good communication skills, good attitudinal skills, and good mindfulness skills to see to it that patients wear the mask. And if you're smiling and if you're very encouraging and inspirational, they will continue wearing the mask. If you're rude, they will wear the mask in your presence, and after you leave the place, you'll bring the mask back to the cheek. So inspire, appreciate, congratulate, and give a smile to those who have brought their mask back on their face.
The question by Sushma Kolte, that if somebody requires the anti-rabies vaccine, how should be the gap between COVID vaccine and rabies vaccine managed? So there are two things, Sushma ji. If there is a immunoglobulin of rabies given, then you need to keep a gap. If a rabies vaccine is also given, any other vaccine is given, usually we keep a 15-day gap. So that is the standard of care, Sushma. Guru Anna, looking at how countries are reacting in pandemics, my question to you is, we are seeing tit-for-tat reactions. We are seeing reciprocal reactions. We are seeing very, very drastically different laws not guided by science. For example, there are countries like Australia and New Zealand which have just shut the world, and they have self-cocooned and self-isolated themselves. We have countries like Singapore which have also gone into a indirect internal bubble. And then there are countries like UK and USA which are open for insiders but not open for some countries like ours. So you see this different types of reactions. Diplomats, missions, external affairs, health, all of them have different advisories. People want to travel across the world. COVID is still around. COVID has not gone. How does one handle the global mental health issue related to COVID crisis of panic, of fear, and of genuine transmission? Because I think go ahead. Sorry.
Actually, Dr. Shashank, governments, policymakers, ministers are not immune to the anxieties of COVID, because COVID is a once in 100 years virus. We know very little about it. Having said this, the influences which they have is how should they protect the people to the best of their ability? What is the right thing for them to do with their own people? And they're also guided by responses of the population, and they also need to maintain the health as well as their popularity with the population. So these are the factors which actually guide them when they use policy. Number two is also, they also see what is happening around. At times, a war-like situation like COVID can cause a lot of paranoia, suspicion, and excessive guard. So when a country refuses a vaccine, which they actually use, it may not be viewed as just a scientific behavior. It may not be viewed as a mindful behavior. It might be viewed with suspicion by another country, and maybe sometimes reacting to that country may have yielded results. But I think what is very important for us to understand that the global epidemic of suspicion, global epidemic of mistrust, global epidemic of what is right and what is wrong is so different for all of us. And so I would say countries may behave in a very ambivalent manner. Countries may behave in a manner which may not appear to be scientific. But as you agreed, Dr. Shashank, when the dust slowly settles and we audit all the behaviors of the countries as well as of the scientific community, we will learn a lot of what worked, what did not work, what erred, and why have they erred. I think we have yet to learn after we look back retrospectively. But you are right. I would say that our country has taken a lot of precautions. We lost our way, but we came back very strongly with a vaccination. We do not know the ground situation in different countries. As you know, there are certain religious factors which stop people from wearing the mask and hugging death. And if you read Chinmay Tumbe's book, they behaved in the same manner, or even worse, during the earlier pandemic. So I think this is a behavioral experiment. It's a lab where human behavior in groups, in isolation families, and in countries will be evaluated after a few years, and we'll know what worked, what was right, and what was not right.
So Guruna, before we move to anger, because a lot of people have asked about anger, there is a question from Mr. GN. I had COVID in April. I have fasting sugar of 115 and A1C of 5.9. How to handle? And is this A1C because of stress and other factors? So one thing is very clear that COVID can trigger underlying stress, metabolic stress, pancreatic stress, and diabetes. A fasting sugar of 115 and 3 months average sugar of 5.9 can be managed by diet, exercise, lifestyle alone. You really don't need to do medicines. You can fully reverse your diabetes, I can assure you. But you need to eat less, you need to eat slowly, you need to eat on time, you need to eat the right thing. You need to have a large breakfast, moderate lunch, and light dinner. You need to do your 10,000 steps per day. You need to do some muscle building exercises. You need to sleep for 7 hours and sleep on time. And we need to stress less. We need to smile. And we need to do a 2-hour digital detox every day. So if you do all that mantra, I think you can reverse this glucose values. And sometimes if you are overweight, you can take a small dose of metformin. Occasionally, we give gluten. And if you have a very strong family history of heart disease in your family or kidney disease in your family, then we can look at giving other medications. So, Guru Anna, Bhavna Saraya is asking this question. Many feel angry, you know, and this is probably the last question, and then you can summarize. Many feel angry now over a period of 2 years. This has become a habit. They have become very finicky, fault-finding, criticized within family and friends. How does one handle anger and how does one manage anger?
Absolutely. So, I think what she's saying is not about anger. She's saying that everybody is very irritable. And irritability is Shashank, anger in motion. Anger is a pure feeling. Irritability is anger in motion. So, my dear Bhavna, I go back to the answer what Dr. Shashank said. Lifestyle changes can bring down anger. That is number one. Number two, please check your glands and your small blood test, your nutrients in the blood, and that might help you. Number three, 10,000 steps. I used to start walking. I used to walk 10,000 steps down. Now I've come down to 5,000, 6,000. I'll come back to 10,000. Can bring down your anger. Number four, diet can bring down your anger. And number five, screen, restriction of screen at night. When the pineal gland says sleep, and you say no, anger can come up. And beyond this, irritability can be a symptom of mass depression, of subsyndromal depression. Irritability can also be a symptom of an unresolved event, an unresolved story, irritability can also be an event of something which is really very painful and hurting you for a very long time. So let us not look at groups of people who are irritable. Let's look at individuals. And for an individual, the reasons may be actually different. So first, the basic lifestyle, exercise, yoga, sleep, clean, away, and good diet. Number two, if not, go back to your life, to go back to your story and see if you have been hurt, see if you have been wrong, see if you have a lot of resentment against somebody. Number three, go back to your neurotransmitter, which your psychiatrist will really help you. I'll tell you, Ms. Bhavna, I have treated a lot of people who have been irritable all their life. And that was depression missed across 15 years. And so many of them have responded and their lives have changed because they took treatment for depression from their friendly neighborhood psychiatrist. So don't really ignore irritability, which is anger in motion, if not relieved by standard procedures of lifestyle changes. Ek bar ko psychologist ke paas jaake aana, and you'll find that things improve. If not, if he or she says that you need psychiatric intervention, please don't hesitate to take something that will settle your neurotransmitters, whatever is the cause. Irritability is the window to understand mood. Irritability is the window to understand depression. Yes, Dr. Shashank?
Sorry, I didn't get your question.
No, I didn't ask. I said, thank you for your question. And I said, over to you.
Final thoughts from you, Dr. Joshi and Dr. Shetty.
So I think, my final thoughts are, we are unlocking and virtually coming back to normal life. Be careful. Don't be reckless. Don't be anxious. Things are going to be fine, but COVID is around. Be mindful and, be happy. Stay happy, stay healthy, and enjoy the festivities, relish the festivities, share it with others. Remember there have been a lot of griefs and miseries, but learn those lessons to be cautious and careful, but don't go overboard on that. Learn the Lakshman Rekha, not to overdo either mentally or physically a little too much. Moderation is the key, and moderation with smile, with happiness, with positivity, with cheer is the way to go. I think we have walked a long, long rope and a very long, protracted year and a half battle with COVID. As we near its fag end in the next 6 months to a year, don't get reckless at all, because we still don't know what is in store for us in the future. Let us hope and pray that things are going to be better. So with that, I think I'll ask Guru Anna for his final thoughts for the day, and we'll close the session. Thank you once again for a patient here.
We recollect the contribution of Mahatma Gandhi. October 2 was his Jayanti. We recollect the contribution of the great Lal Bahadur Shastri. My dear friends, read about him. And we recollect his great contribution in bringing the agrarian revolution and for coining the slogan Jai Jawan Jai Kisan. My dear friends, this is the Mental Health Week, October 3 to October 10th. And this is an opportunity to bring back your lifestyle back to normal, to find out if there's something happening inside your family which needs attention, and knocking the door of the friendly neighborhood psychologist and psychiatrist. With this, I say adieu with Dr. Shashank and Dr. Anirudh. We'll come back again on October 10th, the World Mental Health Day.
Thank you.
At 12 o'clock. Thanks a lot. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Shetty. Thank you, Dr. Joshi.